A metabolic disorder is when something goes wrong with your metabolism, making it difficult for your cells to access the fuel you eat or the energy stored within your body. When disorders of the metabolism get a foothold, they can progress to conditions such as insulin resistance, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, and type 2 diabetes. But this progression can be short-circuited. This video gives you the parameters to understand your current metabolic health and practical ways to improve it. Your metabolism is the collection of chemical reactions that take place every second of the day. The main functions of your metabolism are to change the foods you eat into energy and useful resources and eliminate metabolic wastes. There are many types of metabolic disorders, with some being out of our control due to genetic factors or a lack of access to proper nutrition. However, metabolic disorders can also develop over time due to diet and lifestyle habits. A lack of metabolic health is evaluated based on 5 criteria, including a large waist circumference, high blood pressure, high blood glucose, high triglycerides, and low HDL cholesterol. When 3 or more of these factors are present, the diagnosis is metabolic syndrome. According to Johns Hopkins Medicine, most people who have metabolic syndrome have insulin resistance. Insulin is a hormone made by your pancreas to move glucose or sugar out of your blood and into your cells for use as energy. Factors that are common to those with metabolic syndrome, such as obesity and a diet high in refined carbohydrates, make it more difficult for cells in the body to respond to insulin. In other words, the cells resist insulin's efforts, creating the condition called insulin resistance. Therefore, to move from metabolic syndrome to metabolic health, you want to help insulin do its job. You can do that by making 4 changes to your diet and lifestyle. These changes don't have to be dramatic, but they are necessary to start moving back toward metabolic health. Before we get started, I want to take a moment to talk about this video's sponsor, Element Electrolytes. When you take actions that stabilize or lower your insulin level, 2 things happen. Your body has an easier time releasing stored body fat, and your kidneys release or flush out water and electrolytes. Essential electrolytes include potassium, magnesium, and sodium. Despite its reputation, sodium is needed by your body. Without it, your muscles could not contract, nerves could not relay messages, and you could not regulate body fluids. When it's low, you can experience symptoms from headaches and muscle cramps to irritability and brain fog. In addition to the electrolyte loss due to lower insulin, when you shift toward a metabolically healthy diet, there's no room for processed or refined foods. This change alone reduces your sodium intake by about 70%. Fortunately, electrolytes can be replenished. They can be obtained from foods like slow-simmered bone broth, sea salt, leafy greens, nuts, and seeds, or you can do what I do and supplement your diet with Element. One of my favorite ways to use Element is to slowly stir it into a glass of carbonated water like seltzer and use it as a stopper following a meal. Stopper is a term I use for an item, drink, or activity that makes it easy for me to separate from eating so I can keep from overeating. I also like to use the fizzy drink as an alternative to alcohol. When you drink alcohol, your liver must dedicate a lot of resources and energy to break it down and remove it. Since your liver is so important for metabolic health, this mock cocktail still feels special, but unlike alcohol, benefits my body. Element comes in many great tasting flavors, and if you use my link, drinklmnt.com/Dr. Becky, you can get a free sample pack with any purchase so you can try 8 of their flavors. I'll provide a link to the offer in the description area below this video. Since the primary job of your metabolism is to convert the food you eat into energy, it makes sense that your food choices are important to your metabolic health. One thing that tends to be confusing and run under the radar is fructose. Fructose is confusing because there is added fructose and natural fructose. Fructose, or high fructose corn syrup, is often added to packaged foods and snacks because it's cheap and sweet. Unlike a piece of fruit that has natural fructose locked inside its fibrous matrix, processed foods with added fructose have nothing to slow absorption. Therefore, when you eat junk food snacks or drink sweetened soda or juice, your liver is faced with a flood of fructose. takes a lot of energy to deal with that flood. Do this multiple times a day by drinking juice and soda and eating packaged snacks, and it puts a burden on your liver that leads to inflammation, insulin resistance, and easier weight gain, particularly in the abdomen. That fat that pushes the belly out and feels harder than the soft fat that is pinched under your skin is called visceral fat. This special type of fat forms deep in the belly and is metabolically harmful, increasing your risk of diabetes and heart disease. So natural fructose is better for you than added fructose, but fruits vary in their fructose concentration. When it comes to metabolic health, how much fructose is dumped into your system at one time is a factor. Dr. Peter Attia has an interesting podcast on this topic that I will link to in the description area. There you'll also find a chart showing the fructose content of different fruits. The takeaway is that low fructose fruits like strawberries, blackberries, cantaloupe, lemons, and limes put a low burden on the liver, making them better choices as you work toward better metabolic health than high fructose fruits like dried figs, mangoes, grapes, and surprisingly, watermelon and apples. Because the onset of metabolic disorders is closely related to how your cells respond to insulin, and insulin is secreted in response to rising blood sugar, the best approach to halt the progression is to eat in a way that stabilizes blood sugar. Many studies show that following a low-carb diet has this effect, making the diet a viable approach. And this makes sense when you consider that carbohydrates are the macronutrients that cause the most significant spike in blood sugar and insulin. If you are new to low-carb dieting, you can gradually decrease your carb intake by tracking how many grams of carbs you eat in a day, aiming for no more than 125 grams. For some of you, this can be accomplished by cutting out quick-digesting carbs like soda, sweetened tea and juice, and refined desserts and snacks, what you hear me refer to as the three C's, cookies, cakes, and candies. Depending on your body, you may find that you need to reduce your overall carbohydrate intake further to achieve blood sugar stability. However, you'll likely find that you can keep some slow-digesting carbs in your diet. You'll be happiest with your results when you focus on foods with the best fiber-to-carb ratio, such as leafy greens, non-starchy vegetables, avocados, nuts, and seeds. The fiber and nutrients in these foods slow the rate at which they break down and get absorbed, so you don't need to eliminate all carbs from your diet, just make different choices. And while this idea of eating a lower carb, better carb diet may make sense to you, a challenge that I often see when a person cuts out high carb convenience foods is that they don't replace the carbs with fat. Carbs and fats are the two dietary macronutrients that your body likes to run on. If you cut back on both, you will feel tired and hungry. And this is a bit off topic for this video, and I have many videos on finding this carb to fat ratio for your diet, but I wanted to mention one recent study to counter some of the fears that surround eating foods that contain fat. Now, I realize that not everyone tolerates dairy, but the findings of this study published in July of this year show that up to 2 servings a day of dairy, mainly whole fat, can be included in a healthy diet. This is in keeping with modern nutrition science showing that dairy, particularly whole fat, may protect against high blood pressure and metabolic syndrome. Intermittent fasting is a valuable and easy to implement tool in your strategy to reduce insulin resistance and metabolic syndrome. During your fasting hours, when no food is coming in, there's no rise in blood sugar or insulin, making your body more insulin sensitive over time. Intermittent fasting will meet you where you're at. If you've never fasted before, I encourage you to start with an overnight fast of 12 hours. For instance, stop eating by 7 p.m., resume eating by 7 a.m. When that feels comfortable, add a couple of hours of fasting. To give you some perspective, patients with metabolic syndrome that were being treated with medication were asked in a research study to condense their daily eating window from what was 14 plus hours down to 10 hours. They did this for 3 months and they got significant improvements in their metabolic syndrome criteria. They lost weight, lost belly fat, decreased their blood pressure and fasting blood glucose, and improved their blood cholesterol profiles. Nothing changed with their medications. The only change was that they reduced their eating window to 10 hours. You don't have to skip breakfast to perform intermittent fasting. In fact, once you are comfortable with 14-10 fasting, consider moving your eating window to earlier in the day. For instance, start eating by 7 a.m. and finish eating for the day by 5 p.m. This form of fasting, referred to as early time-restricted eating, has been shown to improve insulin sensitivity and improve the function of the pancreas, which is the organ that produces insulin. Regular exercise makes it easier for your cells to take in glucose, reversing the resistance they once had. When your cells are more insulin sensitive, they have an easier time pulling sugar out of your blood, so there's less in circulation. The exercise does not have to be exhausting to be helpful. Even short, brisk walks after dinner will move you in a positive direction. It has been found that all forms of exercise help. So whether you enjoy aerobic style exercises like walking or riding a bike, or prefer lifting weights at the gym, you will benefit. So let's put this all together so you have a practical roadmap to get started today to move from metabolic syndrome to metabolic health. 1, stop the excess fructose intake by ditching sugary sodas, sweetened drinks, and packaged snacks sweetened with high fructose corn syrup. Diet soda is not a healthy drink, but if you need to switch to it for a few weeks to help get sugary drinks out of your diet, it is a step in the right direction. Then, when you feel more in control, wean yourself off the diet drinks. Something to try is the plain carbonated water that I talked about as my favorite drink to add electrolytes to. 2, eat a lower carb, better carb diet to stabilize your blood sugar, making insulin's job easier. If you need a place to start, I recommend that you download my 0-1-2-3 strategy. It is already in use by more than 200,000 people, and it will help you get started on a healthy diet. Further improve insulin sensitivity by eating within a shortened eating window. When you feel comfortable restricting your food intake to 10 hours a day, try shifting to an earlier time-restricted eating pattern where you finish eating by 5 p.m. And 4, make a concerted effort to move more. Any form of exercise helps your cells take in glucose, so the best exercise for you is the one that you're willing to do. Thank you for watching, and thanks to Element for supporting my channel and helping me continue to bring free content to you. You'll find a link to Element in the video description area below this video. Have a great rest of your day.